So, okay, let me get into Ra now, because it's nice stuff. So, we're going to start on page 30. We're moving right along here. This is card number 4, Experience of the Mind. Now, last time we talked about Catalyst of the Mind, with the notion that everything that comes at us is catalyst. Ra again says, all that assaults your senses is catalyst. This is page 28. We, in speaking to this support group through this instrument, offer catalyst. The configurations of each in your group of body, meaning each in the group of your body, offer catalyst through comfort or discomfort. In fact, all that's unprocessed, that's come before the notice of a mind-body-spirit complex, is catalyst. Catalyst is everything that comes to us, everything that comes up in us, body sensation, perceptions, thoughts, memory, fantasy, imagination, people, places, situations, etc. All of that is catalyst, and the catalyst has a quality of unconsciousness. Ra says, the nature of catalyst is overwhelmingly of an unconsciousness, meaning coming from that which is not of the mind and which has no connection with the intellect, which is very interesting. what comes to us is kind of mysterious. It's veiled. Its meaning is not clear. Why do I feel this sensation? Why am I having these memories? Why do I have these comfortable, uncomfortable emotions? Why is this person in my life? Why am I living where I live? And so Ra says all uses then of catalyst by the mind are those consciously applied to catalyst. And then this is, I'm going to cough a bit. I have a little thing there. Without conscious intent, the use of catalyst is never processed through mediation, ideation, and imagination. So catalyst is unprocessed, meaning stuff just comes to us. People come at us. Stuff comes up in us. It's not processed unless we use, it's really meditation. Meditation, ideation, imagination, subtle sensing, self-reflection, contemplation. This is the interiorization of mind. Interiorization. Interiorizing experience. Catalyst in this sense being, you know, what we experience. Make it your own. What is this about? Why did this person come to my life? What's really going on in him or her? What are these feelings? What can I learn here? That is a reflective self-inquiry, using both intuition and logic and reason and analysis. That's development of heart and mind. Just that wondering, focused wonderment. It's not really wondering, but it's sort of inquiring. It's focused wondering. That is development of fourth and fifth chakra, and that by itself is healing, or increases, or facilitates greater healing. Because it's willing to accept, it's willing to know, it's seeking to make peace with what is or what arises or comes at us and live in understanding. It's seeking to understand. So when we get into the fourth card, Experience of Mind, we see a man sitting on another cube, which is itself again gray or not all black or all white. In the cube appears to be a little fox or a cat. Let's say it's a cat. So we go back to the feline again. The feline or the cat I believe, as I've said, that Ra was came from a 2D feline genetic stock, that we came from big cats. We, being those of us 60 old folks who are from that Venusian group. There's the cat sitting comfortably in the cube that's gray. That's the support for the man. We're looking very Egyptian. Wearing a skirt. No veil over the face. Holding the sphere of magical potential and true being in the right hand, with the left hand angular, aligned or parallel to the skirt, which is very triangular, pointing down, pointing sort of, you know, diagonally down to ground. The triangularity of the skirt, which basically is between knees and waist, not solar plexus, it's below. Basically between the positions of second chakra down to the knees, belly, waist, down to the knees, triangular. The triangularity of it suggests the upward spiraling light from first and second chakra mediated experience, moving into third chakra. And we remember from, or we can see from, the third card, a catalyst of mind, that she had an Ankh. I don't really see it. Maybe it's not the... She, first of all, the catalyst of mind, meaning catalyst, has another triangularity of her arms in the positions from her elbows with her hands. It's actually... another triangularity between the veil that covers her chest. She's naked. So it's, you know, catalyst is very available for joining, which is making use of, or in the way of integration of significance. Catalyst is very available naked, but it is veiled. The significance must be requested. But there's a triangularity of her veil between her elbows and her heart. And Don asked, should she have a Crux Ansata or the Ankh? Yes, Ra said. That's also the case with the experience, the potentiator of mind, who clearly, he looks like Carla to me. In the picture of the potentiator of mind looks like Carla. But... she's visibly wearing an Ankh that goes from third, mid-third chakra, or lower third chakra, up to the heart with its handle, not the handle, sorry, but the horizontal portion of the Ankh being aligned to the diaphragm, in fact, being at the diaphragm horizontal. That, again, indicates that the efficient or awakened use of the potentiator of mind, the deep mind resources, allows transit of the upward spiraling light from the second to the fourth chakra through the diaphragm, holding the handle at the heart, the handle of heart-based seeking. And so when we get to the experience of mind, card four, the triangularity is in his skirt, and again suggests the ascending light from really the knees to the mid-second chakra. These are dynamics of root and second ray, root chakra, second ray. He's wearing a headdress with the Egyptian serpent at the crown, at the third eye position. I believe that's just an artifact of the Egyptian culture, but there is suggestion, I would say, that in the nature of experience, which is processed catalyst, we'll see, when catalyst is processed and we furnish ourselves with experience, we're furnishing a higher self too with experience. And that's the ascending serpent at the sixth ray forehead level. So page 30, Don asks, the fourth archetype is called the emperor and seems to have to do with the experience of other selves and the green ray energy center with respect to other selves. Is this correct? Now, Don is pairing fourth archetype with fourth ray, green ray energy center, and asking if, number one, this card, the emperor, is primarily relational, involving relation with other selves. That's true in that our experiencing of mind or our experience in life is often related to other selves, but not exclusively. And Ra may talk about that. And our furnishing of ourselves with activated catalyst or with carefully considered catalyst is a green ray affair. It does relate to others, but not exclusively. Ra answers, this is perceptive, meaning the idea that it's the emperor card relates to others and green ray center. The broad name for archetype four may be the experience of the mind. In the tarot, you find the name of emperor. Again, this implies nobility. And in this case, we may see the suggestion that it's only through the catalyst which has been processed by the potentiated consciousness that experience may ensue. Thusly, is the conscious mind ennobled by the use of the vast resources of the unconscious mind. So the two pith teachings here are the those two sentences. The nobility of experience of mind is shown by him wearing a crown of some sort, or a royal headdress, you could say, certainly the name emperor, the nobility being related to the fact that only through catalyst processed by potentiated consciousness may experience ensue. Experience, which is processed catalyst. So you see, what comes at us is catalyst. What comes in us, up in us, is catalyst. What we do with it, which is potentiated consciousness. So you see, there's the conscious mind, there's the unconscious mind. The conscious mind is the magical worker who needs potentiation. Seeking thereby, the conscious mind is self-potentiating by opening heart to the resources of the total self, which are accessed by the potentiator of mind or the deep mind. That's called potentiated consciousness. With potentiated consciousness, then, we make use of catalyst. We process catalyst. Catalyst is processed by the potentiated conscious mind. The conscious mind self-potentiates by seeking within in general, or opening a heart to me, to the greater self. Thereby, that potentiated consciousness processes catalyst. That's a very clear view then. When we are self-potentiated by opening heart to our greater selves, seeking to understand with love and acceptance, seeking to know in truth, sincerely. Thereby, we are potentiated consciousness. Thereby, our potentiated consciousness, or we as potentiated consciousness, may process catalyst well. That then leads to experience. Experience, then, is just the word that Ra is giving to the processing of catalyst by potentiated consciousness. Thusly, Ra says, is the conscious mind ennobled by the vast resources of the unconscious mind. And that is the foundation of all creative work. All creativity is a manifestation of the conscious mind ennobled by using the vast resources of the unconscious mind, having self-potentiated, having impregnated itself, having self-fertilized in love, in kindness to self, seeking understanding. Don goes on, or Don asks then, this jumps to session 94, we're at the bottom of page 30. It seems to me that the experience of the mind would act in such a way as to change the nature of the veil so that the catalyst would be filtered, so to be acceptable in the bias that's increasingly chosen by the entity, meaning bias, meaning positive or negative path. He explains, Don asks, so, for example, if he, a person, had chosen the right-hand path, the experience of mind would change the permeability of the veil to accept more and more positive catalyst. This is a little bit distorted, so be careful. Just, you know, understand that this is Don's view. This is not Ra's teaching. He's supposing or wondering if the person who's chosen the right-hand path by this power of the experience of mind, that changes the permeability of the veil in mind to accept more and more positive catalyst. That's not quite so. He's then asking, also then, the other would be true for accepting more negative catalyst if the left-hand path were the one that's chosen. Is it correct? Catalyst is not positive or negative, actually. Catalyst is catalyst. You know, no situation would have emotional charge for the fully balanced entity. Situations don't have emotional charge. Situations as catalysts are what they are. You know, but those on the negative path seek that which can benefit them on the negative path. Those on the positive path seek that which can benefit them on the positive path. So there is a choosing that influences the generation of catalyst, but I personally wouldn't say that catalyst is positive or negative. Anyway, Ra gives their view and says, this is not only correct, but there is a further ramification. The correctness, in my Scott's view, is that, as I said, the orientation of consciousness being positive or negative does indeed influence generation of catalyst. It doesn't necessarily mean catalyst is positive or negative. Those on the positive path seek truth and the opportunity to learn, the opportunity to share truth, and the opportunity to feel happiness with people who can feel it. So that certainly influences situations we choose, places we go, people we meet, and therefore how we feel, therefore catalyst coming in at us and up in us too. That is the selection of catalyst by one who is polarized. Ra explains then, as the entity increases in experience, it shall more and more choose positive interpretations of catalyst if it's upon the service to others path, and of course negative interpretations of catalyst if its experience has been of the service to self path. That's the point. It's not choosing necessarily positive or negative catalyst, because Ra's not saying catalyst is polarized. Catalyst is not quite polarized. But those on the positive path would be choosing a positive interpretation of catalyst. Those on the negative path choose negative interpretations and use of catalyst. So a positive interpretation of catalyst is, you know, I'm in a relationship and somebody feels sad, or the partner feels sad or feels angry. Positive interpretation is a love-based understanding of their woundedness, a love-based understanding of their seeking or their need for something. They need love, they need understanding, they need something or other. That's why they're feeling upset. And their upset is a distortion, and their upset is the result of inadequate self-love, and their upset is related to childhood, dot, dot, dot. That's, you know, a positively based psychological, spiritual interpretation of their process and the catalyst of whatever, anger coming at me, sorrow being blamed on me, you know, whatever. So that's a positive interpretation. Don goes on and asks, so then, the mechanism designed by the Logos of the action of catalyst resulting in experience was planned to be self-accelerating in that it would create this process of variable permeability. Is this an adequate statement? Actually, he's wrong about this variable permeability. So Ross says, there is no variable permeability involved in the concepts we have just discussed. Bang. Drop it. So Don was going along the wrong line here, asking about variable permeability of the veil in mind. It's not that the veil becomes less or more permeable or less obstructive. It's that the seeking becomes stronger and the blend, you know, the veil actually disappears when a person is fully activated in the fourth dimensional body, in the third dimensional body. Meaning, the fourth dimensional field is fully activated in an adept, somewhat, and yet they're still in human body. They still have some veil, and surely the metaphysical veil, as it has been created by the Logos, isn't quite changed, but for that seeker, it's no longer obstructive. So Ra says, there's no variable permeability involved in the concept we've just discussed. Except for this, you're quite correct. Except for this, there's not much else in that last question by Don, but there is actually, Don referred to self-accelerating experience. There is a self-acceleration of positivity and negativity as one continues on one of those two paths. That's true. And therefore, you know, as you meditate more, you love meditation more. As you find response by seeking, you love love more. You love wisdom more. That's the point. When it takes hold, meaning we get a grip, or we're firmly established on the way, then we love the way. I mean, we don't love painful catalysts, but we love the way. So we love love, and we love truth, and we want to be in love, and we want to be in truth. Sure, catalysts can be painful, of course, but we can slowly come to appreciate painful catalysts, even that. You know, we can appreciate the challenge set up by the negatives so we can grow more. I'm grateful to them for what they did to me in 2009. Really, it was a major trigger, catalyst for me personally. Very, very powerful, very, very helpful. The best thing I could have gotten that they came at me on multiple levels in 2009. So I have gratitude for that, really. You know, planet Earth is a great training school for the trained men. We are the trained men, you know, leading the course of evolution through the dimensions. So there is self-acceleration of seeking and knowing and being well on the path, but it's not a self-acceleration of a permeable veil. But the veil does become thinner and thinner personally as we develop. So Don says, okay, now I can understand, to use a poor term, the poor term he's saying is understanding, because it's Ross said, understanding is not of your density. Meaning, the quality of profound heart knowing is not associated with veiled 3D mind. It's associated with unveiled 4D mind. Understanding is a quality of heart chakra. So, but seeking understanding continues to develop fourth ray. So it's fine. But it's not quite native to the 3D mind. So, he says, now I can understand the necessity for the archetype of the catalyst of mind, meaning the furnishing of experience, the experience of catalyst. But he says, Don asks, what's the reason for having a blueprint or model for the experience of mind, other than the simple model of dual repositories for negative and positive catalyst? Again, this is not right. You know, you really have to be careful. Don's questions are quite distorted sometimes, or his questions show embedded misunderstanding. And, you know, I mean, he's the only guy on planet Earth who asked these questions. So, you know, I have a lot of gratitude for that. I mean, you know, he's the only human on planet Earth who asked these questions of one who knows. That's pretty stupendous. And also, his questions embed a lot of minor misunderstandings. So he's wondering about this, is there a logoic blueprint for dual repositories of negative and positive catalyst? And he says, it seems to me that the first distortion of free will would be better served if no model for experience was made. Could you clear that up for me? And Ross says, okay, your question is certainly interesting, and your confusion, hopefully, productive. See, Ra actually steps back and says, with the recognition that there is so much confusion in the question, we need to address the issue of clearing up confusion in general. We need to address the methodology of clearing confusion before we can even get into addressing the points raised by your question. So that's a very skilled teacher. The skilled teacher, you know, Zhangzi said, if it's straight, I help it along. If it's crooked, I leave it alone. So the teacher, knowing when the question is straight, gives a straight answer. The teacher, knowing when the question is crooked, addresses crookedness, not yet the substantial points of the question. So Ra says, your question is certainly interesting and your confusion hopefully productive. We cannot learn teach for the student. We shall simply note, as we have previously, the attraction of various archetypes to male and female. Okay. So, they conclude, we suggest that this line of consideration may prove productive. Hopefully, your confusion is hopefully productive, my dear. Hopefully, your confusion is productive. May you have productive confusion, and may your confusion be productive of understanding. To continue polarization. So, Ra takes a step back and says, we can't learn for you. We simply say, yes, there is a resonance between certain archetypes to the male-female polarity. We remember the first card, magician, so-called, is male. Second card, high priestess, female. Third card, empress, so-called, female. Fourth card, emperor, so-called, being male. So we have male, female, female, male, kind of like a sandwich. The male conscious mind, again, we're not talking about guys and gals. We're talking about polarized energy dynamics of functions of 3D mind and 3D life. Conscious mind has the quality of male. Unconscious mind has the quality or richness of female. So conscious mind has the dynamism, vitality of a male. Unconscious mind, deep mind, has the richness, oceanic fecundity of female. The catalyst arising and incoming has the mysterium and femininity, unconsciousness of the female. Unconsciousness meaning non-conscious, meaning deep and unfathomable, And the fourth card, experience, has the masculine quality of returning into the light of day and definition, with definition, and with orientation, and with renewed focus. Let's just do the next, we're almost at the end of our time. Let's consider a couple more here. Don asks, in the fourth archetype, the card shows a male whose body faces forward. I assume this indicates the experience of mind will reach for catalyst. However, the face is to the left, which indicates to me that in reaching for catalyst, negative catalyst will be more apparent in its power and effect. Will Ra comment on this? Again, we have to hold his questions lightly because there are points that are not true or misunderstandings. But it's so that the body faces forward, the face faces left. That is so. And it is related to dealing with catalyst for sure. Ra says, the archetype of the experience of mind reaches not, O student. So experience doesn't reach. So knock that out. But with firm authority, grasps what's given. The remainder of your remarks are perceptive. The reason that the Empress faces left also is that, as Ra said, the instinctive kind of reflexive use of catalyst is to go onto the left-hand path because, you know, we identify ourselves as a separate self. I'm a body, I'm a mind. And so the nature of catalyst, what comes at us, what comes up in us, normally suggests a self-oriented use, not, you know, universal service to all, because we're self-protective and we're self-surviving and we're seeking what's good for us. And so that's the left-hand pointing or tending of catalyst, naturally. So that's true, but there is no negative catalyst and there is no positive catalyst, so drop it. But Ra says, you guys don't have to drop it, but it's hard to hear Don repeating the same mistake. The archetype of the experience of mind reaches not. So the experiencing of mind is not reaching, but with firm authority grasps what's given. And that's the kingly association of the fourth card, or this function of our mind being experience. And the point is that experience is self-furnished experience, self-furnished, you know, there's no other word for experience than experience, I think, but this experience of mind is a self-furnished experience by a self-potentiated consciousness processing efficiently its catalyst. The efficient or whole, for us, whole heart-mind processing of experience, of catalyst is a self-furnishing by our self-potentiated seeking of experience. That then is a grasping of catalyst by a mature, sincere, self-potentiated consciousness that leads to, processed catalyst, that experience allows us to gain a nobility, a knower of life is one who is ennobled themselves by careful use of catalyst. And then finally, I think this will be our last QA for the session. Don asks or says, the experience, meaning the card, is seated upon the square of the material illusion, which is colored much darker from card number 3. However, there's a cat inside the square. I'm guessing as the experience is gained, the second density nature of the illusion is understood and the negative and positive aspects separate. Would Rock comment on this? Actually, I believe I'm not going to read Don's comments anymore. I'm sorry, because it's not good to bring confusion and misunderstanding into a very difficult subject. So, Don understands that and agrees. So we will now go on with Ra only. But you see, actually, it's a problem, I see, because sometimes Ra is referring directly to Don, but it's difficult, you know? Okay, so I'm going to have to process the questions a bit instead of just reading them, because they're confusing to me while I'm trying to gain a clear view and that he's got a wrong view. Yes, the emperor is seated upon the square that may represent or be related to the material illusion. That's true, because four and square is related to Earth. It is color darker than the catalyst card. There is a cat inside the cube. And he's asking about the nature of the illusion. Ra says, this interpretation varies markedly from Ra's intention. So be careful. Okay. We direct the attention to the cultural meaning of the great cat which guards. Okay. So the cat in the cube is a guard, a guardian of the furnishing, to the furnishing of self with processed catalyst, meaning illuminated experience. What, O student, does it guard? And with Oriflame? And with what Oriflame? I've never seen that word before, and I've never read it on the first reading. Okay, we direct the attention to the cultural meaning of the great cat which guards. What, O student, does it guard? And with what Oriflame does it lighten the darkness of manifestation? Okay, the polarities are indeed present, the separation non-existent, except through the sifting which is the result of cumulative experience. Other impressions were intended by this configuration of the seated image with its milk-white leg and its pointed foot. All right, Ra blows Don's question away and goes to a much deeper level of questioning and encouragement for our seeking. Very, very, very interesting. So what is the card, what is the cat guarding? The cat, I would say, is guarding the carefully processed use of catalyst, or the carefully processed catalyst leads to known, clarified, ennobled experiencing. There is protection of that. What you know, you know. What you realize cannot be taken from you. They can break your body, they can break your brain, they can break your shallow mind, your brain-based mind, but they can't break and take the awakened soul consciousness that comes from the carefully processed use of catalyst, which leads to ennobled experiencing. That remains and is protected and guarded and can't be lost by, you know, destruction of body brain on Earth. So with what Oriflame, Oriflame. Thank you, Corinne. That's perfect timing. An inspiring standard or symbol. Wow. I'd love to see the etymology of that. It's probably aura, or that means gold, I believe. Gold flame, gold fire. I would say it's related to gold fire. Wow. Damn. Only Ra would say that. I bet that word has not been spoken on Earth for 500 years or 300 years. I wonder if the pronunciation is Oriflame or Oriflame. It looks like Oriflame. Hora Flam. Heavy, heavy. Gold fire. Only Ra could say that. And with what Hora Flam does it lighten that darkness of manifestation? Meaning the confusion of the material world, the illusion we live in, being unclear as to what's going on here. The idea is that the cat, or the symbol of the cat, represents the protection and the guarded nature of the ennobled mind, which has ennobled itself by careful use of catalyst. And that careful use of catalyst leading to ennobled, clear knowing, it really is knowing here, is also an enlightenment of the darkness of manifestation. And yeah, sure, the polarities are present. You know, some dynamics are male, some are female. We go on the right or the left path. There are guys on the right and the left path. The paths go on in the polarized way into higher dimensions. However, Ra says, the separation is non-existent, except through the sifting, which is the result of the cumulative experience. The result of the cumulative experience is ascension into fourth dimension. The sifting is the respective harvesting, or the harvesting into respective domain of 4D positive and 4D negative. The sifting is the separation of the ways. And that is a self-sifting. And that's what's happening now on Earth. You know, the harvest on Earth now is logoic sifting, or the sifting guided by the logos and higher self of those souls in 3D which are capable of ascension into fourth dimension, which will be a parting of their ways to positive and negative, 4D positive, 4D negative. That sifting is the result of cumulative experience, meaning the process used of catalyst by 3D souls who place themselves upon positive and negative paths. So yeah, sure, polarities are present here and above. However, there is no separation. The only separate meaning, all is one. All is one. There is no separation. You experience self, but you are not separate from creation. We experience separation, but it's fundamentally an illusion. We are one. I am that I am. All is all. And that truth is the truth of non-separation. The only separation is the manifestation in time and space of the sifting of souls that ascend into 4D positive and 4D negative. They're separated, and they don't hang out together. But that doesn't imply separation. It's all dancing light, right? You are dancing thoughts. It's all twinkling light. It's just twinkling light. The creation is twinkling conscious light. And that light is, you know, of love. So it's not a cold light. It's a colored, lovely, kaleidoscopic, beautiful light. You know, it's a rich colored light. It's not a glare white light. It's a rich, multi-hued rainbow light. Twinkling, dancing, conscious, seeking, loving, happy. That is one. Ra goes on, other impressions were intended by this configuration of the seated image with its milk white leg and its pointed foot. The milk white leg. The foot is pointing straight down. There are 2 feet. There's the right foot, which is aligned with the hem of the triangular skirt, or parallel to the hem, not the hem actually, it's the edge, the descending edge of the triangular skirt, is parallel to the right leg, and parallel to the left arm. And if you want to really be esoteric, the right leg is associated with the third chakra, which is associated with forward self-determined movement in 3D by intellect and individual choice, qualities of third ray. Right leg is the moving forward in 3D. The left arm is the horizontal reception into heart chakra, associated with heart chakra, of catalyst associated with others, and the environment, the horizontal. The arms are horizontal, the legs are vertical, the right leg being parallel to this edge of the skirt, being parallel to the left arm, shows the resonance between the leg that, it shows resonance between the capacity for right leg action, which is moving forward through catalyst on our path, with the careful ascensional use of catalyst from first and second chakra into third. That's the triangularity of the skirt, with and the resonance continuing with the left arm, which receives catalyst from others on the horizontal plane, moving into the heart center. So that's the resonance, and then the left leg is rooted, or straight down. And those are my early impressions or interpretations of the configuration of the pointed feet, or the feet. And the milk-white leg is the purity, of the one who experiences well-processed catalyst, the one who experiences carefully processed life, is a pure receiver and has a purity of anchoring on earth, because the well-processed use of catalyst leads one to be clearly on their path. On the positive path, in this case, that's the milky white, the purity of the person's anchoring and their step forward. The anchoring left leg, the moving forward right leg, second ray, third ray, that purification of second and third ray, and one's anchoring and movement forward on the earth plane, that comes from the carefully processed use of catalyst. It leads to the ennobling of mind enriched experiencing and capacity for experiencing. All right. How's that? So that concludes the raw portion, and that ends page 31. We'll continue with card number 4, the Emperor, and the relation between card 4 and 3, and some other interesting points in the next session. There are actually a couple more pages on this card 4, and Don asked a lot about it. There are a lot of pages on card 4, so that's good. That'll give us a very good foundation, solid foundation, in knowing what is ennobled experiencing. It only comes after potentiated self-potentiated consciousness that has used and processed catalyst carefully, and in balance. All right, so that'll finish raw for today.